There's a verse in Lamentations, chapter 3, verse 22. It says this: "It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness."
Amen.
Song made famous by George Beverly Shea, who sung at Billy Graham's funerals, revivals. Spoke the dead back to life, I guess. Number 140 in our hymnals, we'll put the words on the screen also for you, is "Great is thy faithfulness." I encourage you to stand if you're able and sing with us. "Great is thy faithfulness." This morning, whether it's your first time or first time in a long time, or you're here faithfully every week, we just welcome you. We're glad you're here. My name is Brad, and we are leading you through this service today. We had a big event at church yesterday, as many of you are aware. Tabitha Nicosia came to me about a year ago and said, "God has put this event on my heart. Let me explain it to you." And she explained it to me, and I guess tepid in my response. Said, "Okay, well, listen. If this, we're all for saying yes. So if you think this is what you want to do, run with it. Go for it. We'll have the full backing of the congregation beside you." And I think even so, a couple weeks ago, people were like, "They're not going to turn out for this. Is this a, what are we doing with this? Is it a money maker? Is it whatever?" But I love Tabitha's heart here, because she said, "We've been here. I think this is our 1 year anniversary. We've been here. Wow, we opened 1 year ago today, so happy anniversary, I guess. Woo! We have come a long way, baby." But our hope was that so many people don't even know we're here yet. They think the school is still closed, whatever's happening, but we wanted a way just to reach out and just love our neighbors. The point of yesterday was never to raise a bunch of money. It was just to love our neighbors, reach out to kids. And we've had so many people say, thank you for having something just for kids to do. A lot of free stuff, a lot of different things. It was wonderful. If you were here at any part of the day, just walking around and just seeing the kids, we're estimating probably well over 300 people.
Wow.
So it was a tremendous turnout. We did raise much more money than we ever thought we would raise, so that's a wonderful thing. Yes, Tabitha put this thing together, but it was all of you who prayed. I took a lot of credit for the weather yesterday. But that's all glory to God. I just was praying. Let it rain all day Thursday, let it rain all day Friday, but Saturday, just give us mid-70s with a nice breeze, and there we go. But for so many people who help set up, take down, clean up, just walk around, just be there, perfectly supporting us, you made that event very successful. I talked to the last vendor I talked to, said, would you come back? I said, I can't wait till next year. I said, oh, how'd you do? Did you do okay? And we had like a $30 vendor fee to set up, and how'd you do? I made over $700.
Wow.
Okay, wow. It was an awesome, wonderful event.
Little fairies that were walking around were adorable.
Every the face painting, there was the birds were great. It was a wonderful thing. So, thank you for making it a rousing success. Any way you played a part in it, we did talk to several families who said, "You know what? I've been looking for a church. What time is service tomorrow? Some of those folks showed up today. Amen. We have new people from our yesterday's event. So, praise God. Tabitha, have you make a speech, but I know you're totally exhausted. Because when Jeff cooked, I can't tell you how many hamburgers and hot dogs yesterday and stuff. So, well done, Foothills. Well done. We may see the rewards of this for a long, long time. So. Tremendous, tremendous event. So thank you for all the ways you supported us doing that. We are going to take this morning's tithes and offerings. I would encourage those of you who are joining us for the first time, we don't need your money, but we'll take it. We're not foolish. But the church is faithfully supported by its membership. Don't feel under any obligation or compulsion to give. We give because of what God has done for us. We give because he's given everything to us. Ministry takes a lot of funding. It just does. We continue. As you walk around even today, you'll see I put a new sign up out there. And we notice that sign. We're going to keep adding things. We haven't given up on air conditioning for this room. We got two more estimates this past week. Less than half of what the first one was. So that's a good thing. So we're still working on those. But for all the ways you can give of your time, your talents, your treasures, we are most appreciative. And we thank you for that. We're going to pray and just thank God before we take this morning's offering. Lord God in heaven, we thank you for this day you've given to us, a day to rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you for yesterday's event, Lord, which was just fun, God, to bless the children, the families, and this community. That's what we're about, Lord, reaching them with Jesus' love. Bless this time of worship, Lord, as we give back to you our very best gifts. We give them cheerfully, willingly, God, because you so graciously given to us. We use these funds to support the ministries of the church, to keep the lights on, but to bless the community and be in mission to all people. Bless these gifts and those who are able to give. In Christ's beautiful name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Judi Merriam is going to bring, she's back for a return engagement. You were here for the
Station
of the Cross. Yes, thank you, thank you. Welcome, I'll let you go.
Thank you.
With the song, I Will Go.
I'm delighted to be here this morning. Just loved being here for Stations of the Cross. What a delightful congregation you are. And when Malcolm told me that Pastor Brad was talking about faithfulness this morning, the fruit of the Spirit, faithfulness, I thought about some songs I could sing. And this is one of my favorites. It is entitled, Yes Again, I Will Go. But it just talks about the fact that life is a journey. Mm-hmm. And every day is a journey. And we need to be willing to live every day as that journey that God calls us to. And we need to be willing to go. Obviously, the Fairy Festival was a perfect example of that from what you just said. We need to be willing to take the journey that God calls us to.
Yes.
everything turn out fine, but to be godly and make an impact on our dying world and its values.
Them over with you and put them down at the place where you stay tonight. So Joshua called together the 12 men he appointed from the Israelites, one from each tribe, and said to them, "Go over before the ark of the Lord your God into the middle of the Jordan. Each of you is to take up a stone on his shoulder according to the number of tribes of Israelites to serve as a sign among you. In the future, when your children ask you, 'What do these stones mean?' tell them that the flow of the Jordan was cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. When it crossed the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan were cut off. These stones are to be memorials of the people of Israel forever." So the Israelites did as Joshua commanded them. They took 12 stones from the middle of the Jordan, according to the number of the tribes of the Israelites, as the Lord had told Joshua, and they carried them over with them to their camp where they put them down. Joshua set up the 12 stones that had been in the middle of the Jordan at the spot where the priest who carried the Ark of the Covenant stood, and they are there to this day. Now the priests who carry the ark remain standing in the middle of the Jordan until everything the Lord had commanded Joshua was done by the people. Just as Moses had directed Joshua, the people hurried over as soon as all of them had crossed the ark of the Lord, and the priests came to the other side while the people watched. The men of Reuben, Gad, and the half-tribe of Manasseh crossed over ready for battle in front of the Israelites as Moses had directed them. About 40,000 armed for battle crossed over before the Lord to the plains of Jericho for war.
Thank you, Debbie.
You're welcome.
Judy's back.
Right now.
Oh, okay.
Is that okay?
Sure.
And then I'll pray.
Okay. All right. Look at that. Some of you might remember from the Stations of the Cross when I was doing my reading, I talked about my little child who took his life 12 years ago at Christmas time. And what that looked like, and what that means to me today, and what that means to the world. And I wrote a book, if you wanted to see me afterwards, I wrote a book called Empty Shoes at the Door. It's the story of my journey. It's the story about my son. These are my son's actual shoes. They still sit by my front door, and when I move, they will always go with me. My daughter did the picture. She was an art major. And it's empty shoes by the door, living after my son's suicide. And I go out and speak a lot, and when I speak, I love to end with this song, Not for a Moment, because I wouldn't have been able to sing this song at first after Jensen took his life. I was not in a good place, which is understandable. Life is really, really hard. We are not promised an easy life. Nowhere in the Bible does it tell us we're guaranteed an easy life. But in spite of that, we need to be faithful. That doesn't mean that we're not going to question. That doesn't mean that we're not going to yell at God. It doesn't mean any of that. It just means that in our faithfulness, we continue to walk with God. And this song, Not for a Moment, says that God is good, God is constant, and God is sovereign. And the reality is, I don't always know what those three things mean, because I don't always see good things. I don't always see constant things. And I don't always know what God's being sovereign looks like. But I do know that that is the truth. He is good. He doesn't do the bad things. He is constant. He holds on to us, and he is sovereign. And he redeems those horrible things in our life.
Amen.
And the one thing that I love about this song is that it says that not for a moment does he ever leave us. He never leaves us. He never forsakes us. When we are faithful, when we continue putting one foot in front of the other, no matter how hard it is, God is carrying us even when we don't know that. So not for a moment are we ever left alone.
Thank you. think we're done.
I'd like to hear her again.
What I love about that rendition of that song, because I've heard people sing, it's like the other day I heard like a 10, 11-year-old boy sing a song about love. A 10-year-old know about love, come on, really, let's be honest. And we can sing a song about faithfulness and God is true and God is always good. But then to experience the brokenness of the world and the hard, difficult times where you want to just scream out at God and you wonder why God has allowed things to happen. In the midst of that, in the midst of your son taking his life on Christmas, to be able to stand before a group of people and say, God is good. God is faithful. That's a faith I aspire to. So thank you, Judy, for blessing with us for that. I misspoke earlier when I said Billy Graham's funerals, but funerals have kind of been on my mind. We have another one tomorrow. It's a fourth one in 10 days. So pardon my thoughts on funerals. There's people going through stuff. And I'm aware of the, we used to call it the pain in the pews, but the trouble in the church. I mean, there's stuff you guys are going through. Stuff that maybe nobody else knows. Stuff that's maybe private between you and your spouse, or maybe your spouse doesn't know. We're all struggling in some kind of way. And the only thing that helps is Jesus. He alone brings that peace. He alone brings that comfort. He alone brings that understanding and that hopefulness that we have. Everything is okay in the end. If it's not okay, it's not the end. God is leading us through these things. And what I've found oftentimes is that it's in the midst of those that God is really developing us, cultivating that Christ-like character in us, making us become more and more like Jesus. So as we come together this morning, as we pray to God for our collective needs, our individual needs, know that we have a God who hears us, who loves us, who understands us, and wants to help us in our times of trouble. Let's pray together. Lord God in heaven, you are good because you're God. And oftentimes, Lord, we can't see that goodness because we blame you for things like cancer and hurricanes and but you, God, are always good. You always love us and you take care of us and you provide for us. And morning by morning, new mercies we see. You've blessed our lives in imaginable ways with the breath in our bodies, with the movements, with the ability to love and care for family and friends and for food and for shelter and for music and all the wonderful things, nature, children laughing. It's all a gift from you, God, and we are most thankful, we are most blessed. You told us, Lord, in the Bible, that in this world you will have trouble. And man, we've seen it. We're seeing it now. Life is hard. It's difficult. But you promised us, and you are faithful. You've never broke a single promise you've ever made. That when we walk through the darkest of the valleys, you are with us. Your hand, your words comfort us. So thank you for being with us in those difficult times of life. But thank you for helping us. It's hard being a parent. It's hard being a husband or a wife. It's hard being a good worker or a boss. It's hard to be a good student. It's hard, God, and you know that because you experience every single bit of that. So just help us, Lord, in places that we need your help. Protect our children at school. Watch over our places of worship, Lord. Help our government to be good to its people, make wise and important decisions. We pray for the end of wars all over the place. We pray for financial stability. We could all use money to pay off the credit cards and pay bills and just medical stuff. And it's, Lord, thank you for gainful employment. Thank you for the ability to work and earn money. We thank you, God, for this church, the ministry that it offers, the hope that it has. We pray for these things, God, so many more, unspoken and spoken within our hearts. You know our needs before we ask. And we pray these things, praying them as you taught your own disciples to pray, by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. By the way, you know what it means when a pastor takes his watch off and puts it on the desk? Absolutely nothing. There's absolutely nothing, so don't go. I have an 8-page manuscript prepared, half hour. I'm not sure I'm going to get to all of it, but I wanted to share this with you because God laid this on my heart, revealed this to me. Last week we talked about goodness and kindness. We talked about the story of the Good Samaritan, right? Remember that story where a Samaritan, the least likely of the group of folks who went past this man who'd gone through a really difficult time, helped him. Because we learned last week that the Jews strongly disliked the Samaritans. They thought they weren't part of the kingdom of God, that they were just unworthy. They're sworn enemies. And so in understandable response, the Samaritans didn't like the Jews either. And in chapter 4, I just want to show you something real quick, because this stuck with me today. In John chapter 4, the Gospel of John chapter 4, it says that, in verse 3 it says, so Jesus and his disciples left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. So if you imagine on a map, so Judea is down here, and Jesus and his disciples, his 12 followers, are going up to Galilee. From Judea to Galilee. It's about a 70-mile walk. I always try to park close as I can to the place I'm going into for business. He's walking 70 miles. Took him several days. By far the shortest route was just right straight, the direct route from Judea to Galilee, straight route. The problem is right in the middle of that road is the country of Samaria. And Jews didn't want to go through Samaria. They didn't want to see him, didn't want to talk to him, didn't want to stay, didn't want to get food, didn't want to do anything. So what most Jewish people would do is they would go the long way around. Instead of the short, direct highway, they'd go all the way around, take an extra 2 or 3 days to get there. Think about that. Have you ever disliked someone so much you spent 2 or 3 days avoiding them? I mean, that's a strong dislike. But the Bible says, now Jesus had to go through Samaria. Well, he didn't have to, I guess, because again, he could go around. But he said, no, we're going to go through Samaria. It's important. He says he had to go through Samaria. So he goes through Samaria, and he stops. And I love this, too, because it says, Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by a well. It reminds me of the humanity of Jesus. You walk, again, you're probably 35 miles in. I'm tired. Jesus got tired. Jesus got thirsty. Jesus sat down because he was tired. Disciples going to town. He's sitting in a well, and it's about noon, the Bible says. And a Samaritan woman shows up to get water. Now, first of all, nobody gets water at noon because it's stinking hot. So nobody goes there. But this is when the woman goes because she wants to avoid everyone else. She wants to avoid people. Jesus gets talking to her. And he says, listen, I know you've had five husbands. You had five husbands. And the guy you're living with now is not your husband. There's something going on here. Let's talk about what the real issue here for you is. This story is one of the greatest stories of repentance in the Bible. Now, there's not really a verse in here about repentance, but what happens is, it says, I think it's in verse 28, it says, so after this woman talked to Jesus, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, come see the man who's told me everything I ever did. Could this man be the Messiah? So she went to the well to get water and to avoid people. She meets Jesus. And suddenly it says she leaves the water bottle. She doesn't get the water. And she goes to meet people. She goes into the town and tells, listen, come meet the Messiah. First time Jesus revealed himself as the Messiah. And so the town people begin rushing and flooding to Jesus. It says many of the Samaritans from that town believed in Jesus because of the woman's testimony. Because of his words, many of the Samaritans became believers. So many Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed 2 extra days. This woman had an encounter with Jesus. Everything about her life changed. I'm looking for water, devoid people. She leaves the water, she goes to people. And I love it, too, that Jesus spends a couple more days in Samaria preaching, teaching the people. And he's still not late for his appointment. Because if I don't went around, it would have been 2 or 3 days anyway. But here's what got me about this story. The line where it says, Jesus had to go through Samaria. And Samaria sounds a lot to me like some area. Jesus had to go through some area of this woman's life. A woman who's made mistakes, a woman who's been probably at least thinking there's been some unfaithfulness in some of those weddings. You're married 5 times, you're living with a 6th person, there maybe there's some unfaithfulness there, some mistrust, some misunderstanding, some whatever. But there was some area of this woman's life that was empty, that was devoid of meaning, that didn't have a real purpose. And Jesus came because he had to go through that area of the woman's life. And he changed everything about her, which in turn changed and did the whole town. And I wonder today if there's not some area in your life that maybe it's not just working right. That maybe you've had failed relationships. Maybe you've had failure, you can't hold down a stinking job. Maybe you failed and failed over again trying to discipline your kids and raise your kids upright, you're struggling with that. Or maybe it's financial. Every time you get money, then you have no money, you're back in debt again, and maybe there's some area of your life you've kept hidden. You don't want anybody else to know about. So you try to stay off by yourself and stay away from people, stay away from church. But Jesus had to go through some area. And he wants to go through some area of your life today. He wants to radically change things. And hear me when I say this, because I say it often. God is not mad at you. God is not disappointed in you. God loves you just as you are. He didn't ask this woman to do radical things. He just said, listen, let me in. The things that you're looking for, the things of this world, are not going to satisfy you. I can satisfy you. I can meet your deepest needs. Jesus can do that for you. What is some area of your life that Jesus needs to go to? Because he has made himself available to us. Those followers of Jesus came back from town with some food because Jesus was hungry. And the first thing they said is, why are you talking to this woman? Jesus said, I see a need in her life and I want to help her. I see an emptiness that I want to fill. Disciples didn't quite understand. They didn't quite understand this holiest of meals that he was about to prepare for them the night before his death. But he saw an empty place in our hearts and our lives. He gathered with his friends, his disciples, sat down to share a meal with them. He took an ordinary loaf of bread, turned his eyes to heaven and thanked God for the bread, broke it into pieces. It says, this bread represents my body broken for you and for many, for the forgiveness and remission of sins. And as often as you can eat of this, do so. After the meal, he took the cup. He says, this cup is symbolic. It's representative of my blood shed for you, for many, for all. For the forgiveness and remission of sins, as often as you can, drink from this cup. For it is a cup of life and of salvation. Do this in remembrance of me. Lord God, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts through Christ Jesus, we give you thanks today. For the empty places in our life, God, the some areas that need to be touched by you, may this meal remind us that you are for us and not against us, that you are forever faithful even when we fail away. You are faithful, God, and your love extends through generations and generations. May this meal become for us the body and blood of Christ, that we receive it, may be redeemed, renewed, restored, forgiven, loved, and free. We pray this all in Jesus' beautiful name. Amen. I believe I have some folks assisting me this morning. Invite them to come forward at this time. If they will, please. The body of Christ. Take and eat. Miss Mary. The body of Christ. The blood of Jesus offered to you, Jan, the blood of Christ given to you. Thanks be to God. Keystone Cops, is that what we're doing here? Go around the table. Hey, here's what we're going to do, folks. Here's just my words of instructions. Perhaps it's new to you. We offer an open communion table. It means if you've repented of your sins, want a relationship with God, this meal is for you. There's a small piece of bread. You hold out your hand, we'll give you a small piece of bread, a little cup of grape juice. You can take, move back to your seat. You can drop the cups over here if you like. You're free to do business with God as you see fit. I know some church, well, we're not a part of the church. We can't take communion. I'm Catholic. I can't take communion. Everyone is welcome. Please understand that. If it's difficulty moving around, I get that. You simply raise your hand. We'll meet you in your seat and provide the meal for you. But this is your meal. Why don't you come and receive it.
Thank you.
God, I thank you for this opportunity to celebrate communion with you. Thank you for what it signifies, what it reminds us of. Fill us with your goodness, Lord. Make us more and more like your Son, Jesus, less like our sinful selves. Thank you, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, I probably don't have a half hour, do I? Well, boy, we're going to have to record this and put this on YouTube for later. So what if I do this? What if I skip pages 1, pages 2, pages 3, pages 4? What if I try these last few pages? Within 5 minutes, I'll see if I can do this. All right? So this is important stuff. We're talking about fruits of the Spirit, right? We're talking about cultivating Christian character. This is all based on, we're skipping that song, obviously. fruition based on this verse from Galatians 5, 22 and 23. The fruit of the Spirit is, say it with me, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. We've worked through those. Those are on the website. Those are on YouTube with all the message notes and vice versa available for you. Faithfulness is today. God has been forever faithful. He's never broken a single promise that he's made to his people. God is forever faithful. So how can we develop fruitfulness? Let me give you 5 practical steps really quick. 5 ways that we can be faithful. Number 1, start with the small things. Be faithful in the small things. Jesus said, if you're faithful in a few things, I'll put you in charge of many things. I've said this before. My very first church had like 4 people in it. No running water, no bathrooms, 4 people. And I said, God, I want a big church. And God said, you be faithful in the little things, and bigger things will happen. It's almost like, you know, faithfulness means like we give God, you know, $10,000, and we're good for our lives. But it's more like we take that $10,000, go to the bank, and we get it all in quarters. And it's a quarter here, and it's a quarter here, and it's a quarter here. And all those little things begin to add up to a life and a pattern of faithfulness. We're on time. We're dependable. We're committed to relationships. We pay our bills. We handle our income. We take care of responsibilities. We do these little faithful things, quarter at a time. We start there. Start with the little things, and little things become big things. Faithfulness in a little thing is a great thing. Start with the little things. Number 2, be meticulous in all of your dealings. Be meticulous in all of your dealings. Whatever you do, do it for the glory of God, right? Don't cut corners. Don't take shortcuts. Don't start things and not finish them. Take responsibility. Follow through with stuff. Do your job well, right? Cashier hands you back too much change. It's probably not going to hurt the store. It's going to hurt your integrity. Give that money back. Be honest. Tell the truth. If you're married, be real careful dealing with the opposite sex. Live above reproach in every way. Billy Graham said, I won't be alone with a woman who's not my wife, alone in a room, just me and her. I'm not going to put myself in that situation. Be careful getting on Facebook and looking up your old girlfriends, old boyfriends, and just don't mess with that stuff. If you're being tempted, get out of that situation. Don't do it. Let me repeat that. Don't do it. Number 3, concentrate on being faithful when no one else is watching. Makes sense, right? I remember there was a cafeteria line. Kids are going through it. And there's a big sign here by the oranges that says, take one orange because God is watching. Right? The other end of the line is the apples. And so the kid goes through, he takes one orange, he said, he took like 3 apples because God's watching the oranges, right? No, God is always watching you. Not looking at stomping and looking to make a mistake, but God sees all things. You're not hiding anything from him. You might hide it from your spouse, your wife, your kids, whatever, but God knows. Concentrate on being faithful when no one else is watching. Who are you when no one else is watching? What if everything you did was on the front page of today's paper? It's on the leading story of the news. Here's what Pastor Brad did today. Would I be okay with that? Would you be okay with that? That's number three. Concentrate on being faithful, no one is watching. Number four, in difficult situations, make up your mind ahead of time to be faithful. Make up your mind ahead of time. Because listen, things are going to happen. And if we at the last minute, we decide what we're going to do, we'll be overcome by poor choices. Bible says in Psalm 91:4, God's faithfulness is a shield. It's a protection against us. Right? Again, if we decide, no, listen, I know this is going to be tempting to eat that chocolate cake that's in the kitchen when I get home, but I'm not going to eat the whole thing. I've got to protect yourself. Make plans ahead of time. When I go to this event, when I do this thing, I am going to be faithful. Because in the moment, you're caught up in the moment stuff, so make plans ahead of time to be faithful. Number five is the last one. It's be slow to make promises. Keep the ones that you make. We've committed to do something to spur the moment right, and later we regretted it. It's better to say no than to say yes and not carry through. God is forever faithful. 2 Timothy 1:12, that's I think was on the screen for a second ago. 2 Timothy 1:12 says, "For I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep what I have committed to him until that day." I can stand on the promises of God. He is faithful. What would this church look like if everyone was faithful as you? What would it look like? Are we faithful in our attendance, our giving, our responsibility, our kindness? God's faithfulness extends to generations. He who's promised is faithful. What about you? What about me? Let's pray. Lord God, that was the quickest message I ever gave. I think the congregation would say amen. But Lord, help us. It's not easy to be faithful. But help us a little more each day. Be more faithful to loving our children, loving our spouses, to being good workers, to loving the church, to loving and serving you. God, may we be found faithful. In Jesus' name we ask and pray. Amen. Let's sing this last song called "Where He Leads Me, I Will Follow." It's number 338, "Where He Leads Me." Let's sing that together. Come on.
Thank you.
Thank you, folks. Judy, that was great. Thank you for sharing your music with the losers. Malcolm, as always, my friend. Thank you to each one of you who came. We hope that you're faithful. We see you again. Right down the hallway to the right is a coffee hour place, a place to sit down and just meet people and talk to people and just relax. You're all invited. We did not sell all the baked goods yesterday. So there's some really good stuff. It's good for you. No calories in church this time. We'll record this message. We'll put all of it up on YouTube for you. I've been on the Facebook page. But thank you for coming. God bless you. He loves you, and so do I. Have a great week, church. Peace.